my kind of town. Uxbridge is my kind of razzmatazz, and it has all that jazz. And each time I leave, Uxbridge is tugging at my sleeve. Uxbridge is the Mumford Falls. Uxbridge is those Milltown walls. Uxbridge is one town that won't let you down.
And welcome to another episode of Uxbridge, My Kind of Town. Thank you for joining us. And thank you for all the emails that you sent us about our premiere show. And also, some people sent us some great story ideas as well. And remember, if you have a story idea, or you think you'd like to be a guest on Uxbridge, My Kind of Town, you can contact us by emailing us at uxbridgemykindoftown, all one word, at hotmail.com. Or you can call me at 508-278-5131. I think we have a great show for you this month, so on with the show.
Hi, I'm here with a very smart-looking, giggly bunch of girls from Junior Girl Scout Troop 730 of Uxbridge, of the Montechuset Council, and that we're here with their troop leader, Danielle Patterson. How you doing?
Good, how you doing?
Good. And these young ladies are selling Girl Scout cookies, but they have a special spin to their Girl Scout cookies. Why don't you tell us about that?
They're looking to sell Girl Scout cookies. They'd like to send over to the soldiers overseas from the local area. Their slogan is, donate a box of cookies to the soldiers and we'll ship them for you.
Wow, that's great. So you girls are selling cookies. So how much are the cookies if I wanted to buy a box to eat myself? Anyone know? Go ahead. You don't have
$3.50.
$3.50. Wow, that's a bargain. And you're holding my favorite kind right there, thin mints. So if anyone's going to buy me a box of cookies, can I see those for a second? I promise I'll give them back. Thin mints, my favorite kind. And how much is it if I want to buy a box of cookies to send to the soldiers? Go ahead.
$4.
$4. And what's he has? 50 cents goes towards shipping?
Yes.
Okay. Well, isn't that nice? So you girls think that I would imagine that the soldier would be pretty happy over in the desert receiving a delicious box of Girl Scout cookies, don't you? Yeah, I think. Now, what are you girls raising all this money for? Go ahead.
Six Flags.
Six Flags? What do you mean? You might have a trip to Six Flags? Yes.
We're going to camp there.
Huh?
We're going to camp there overnight.
You're going to camp at Six Flags overnight. So if these girls sell enough cookies, you're going to actually get to camp at Six Flags. So it's all kinds of good things going on here. You can buy a box of cookies for yourself. You can buy a box of cookies that are going to get shipped to the soldiers overseas. And then the girls, if they sell enough boxes, they get to go to Six Flags as well. So where are you going to be selling these cookies?
We will be at either Photosite, which is located in the Hannaford's parking lot, or the Habitat on February 4th and 5th. Otherwise, from this weekend coming up all the way through March 19th, we will be at the Photosite.
And that's going to be on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday?
Yes, Friday nights from 5 to 8, Saturdays and Sundays from 9 to 2.
Okay, and will these girls be there selling the cookies?
Yes, you'll have an assortment at different times. Also, we have another troop that I'm leadership to, and that is Troop 335, an older group of girls that are not here tonight because they are selling up at another location.
Right.
But you also see their faces as well.
And that's Lori Basner's troop, right?
She's the Lori Basner, myself, Danielle Patterson.
Okay. And, well, you girls are doing a wonderful thing, and I wish you all the luck. in the world, and I hope that you get to go on that trip to Six Flags. Do you want to say goodbye to everybody? Go ahead.
Bye.
So that's it. We've been meeting with the Junior Girl Scout Troop 730 and their troop leader, Daniel Patterson, and buy a box of Girl Scout cookies and send it to the troops.
Well, I left my home down on the rural route. I told my pa I'm going stepping out and get the honky-tonk blues. Hey, the honky-tonk blues. Hey, Lord, I got them. I got the honky-tonk blues.
Our next guest is the brand new town manager for the town of Uxbridge, Jill Myers. Hi, Jill.
Hi, David.
Thank you very much for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me. It's exciting.
So, you're starting your new job very soon. When's that going to be?
February 21st.
Oh, okay. Well, what I was hoping to do here tonight was just to let people get to know you a little bit. So I wanted to ask you a few questions about, like, where did you grow up?
Okay. Grew up in Los Angeles,
oh.
One of the original Valley girls,
oh.
San Fernando Valley. Went to school at UCLA, so stayed pretty much in that same area.
Uh-huh.
And just the typical Valley type of scene. You go to the beach at Malibu Beach, you go into Hollywood, and it was pretty exciting. But not as exciting as it is in the movies, though.
Not as exciting as Uxbridge.
I don't know.
Well, I don't know if Uxbridge compares to Los Angeles, but... So how long have you been in New England?
We came out in 98,
uh-huh.
And we landed in Medway. My family is in the heavy construction business, so they had a couple of tunneling contracts. Not the Big Dig, but the MWRA tunnel project.
Oh, that's the that tunnel they were digging from Wachusett Reservoir, I think?
Yeah, they coabined, go through Framingham, Southboro, Weston, and then got into Boston as their water supply.
Oh, so did your whole family come out here, or was it...
Most of my in-laws did.
Your in-laws did. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, so you landed in Medway.
Landed in Medway.
And so where do you live today?
I live in Shrewsbury today.
Oh, okay. Very good. And so your educational background, you said you went to UCLA?
Yeah, UCLA, political science major, public administration, economics, typical, you know, poli-sci geek. Very involved in student government.
Oh, were you? What did you do in student government?
I held an elected position in student government.
Uh-huh.
And then, you know, worked on campaigns and was really lucky to be there when Dukakis was there doing his presidential speech. So it was Dukakis and I just forgot, Bush.
Bush.
I believe.
Right, George Bush.
George
Senior.
Bush, yeah, they had a debate there, and that was really exciting.
Oh, and so you got to meet them and everything
so
as a
student?
Yeah,
that was my first taste of Massachusetts.
Wow, that's great. So what did you do, what positions did you hold in student government?
It was a general rep position, basically representing, you know, all the student body. You had like five of them.
Right.
And then involved in lobbying. Sacramento's the state capital, so we got to go there twice a year to lobby on behalf of the college system, the UC system. So that was exciting.
Yeah, so that's a pretty big deal for a college the size of UCLA.
Yeah.
Oh, it that's was. Great.
Yeah.
So you're on the, I saw that you're on the governor's task force in Massachusetts mm-hmm. on local government. So what's that all about, and how does that help you out with your activities as town manager?
It's part of the Mass Municipal Association, mm-hmm. MMA, and MMA has an elected board of officials, per se, but you're elected by your peers. And so the district I represent is a district in more in Western Mass. It's not part of, Uxbridge is not part of it. Mm-hmm. And there's monthly board meetings, but a part of that monthly board meeting is a meeting with the Lieutenant Governor and the Governor, and that's the assignment to the local government task force. So it's very efficient on time. We have 2 minutes to talk with either the governor or the lieutenant governor about certain issues, local aid or health care, whatever the pressing need is or topic of the time. And it's not just me, but there's a whole group of us. There's about 20 people that serve on it.
Oh.
And it's at the State House. And it's interesting because it's a one-on-one with either the lieutenant governor or the governor. And it's nice when they know your face as you come in, they know you're serious about local government, and they listen to what we have to say.
And it must be nice, too, when you have to pick up the phone on behalf of whatever municipality you're working for and ask them a question.
Yes, it doesn't. It's not that glamorous, but yes.
Right.
Okay. It works sometimes.
So what is your background in municipal management? Where are you working now?
I'm the town administrator in the town of Charlton. Mm-hmm. I've been there about 3.5 years. Came there, basically it was my first job as a town administrator. Prior to that, I had served as the assistant town administrator in the town of Northborough.
Oh.
And then before that is where I really became acquainted with Uxbridge. I served as the executive director for a group called MORE, Municipalities Organized for Regional Effectiveness, MORE. And it was a group of 22 cities and towns, and together for joint purchasing, expanding management capacity, which is sharing professional services and so forth. But it was municipal-based. Oh. And the representatives were the town managers or the chairman of the Board of Selectmen. And at the time, I believe it was Harry Fortner. He served on it.
And oh, I met him. Howard Fortner.
Howard Fortner,
right,
I'm sorry.
Right.
Harry's the current chair.
He used to be a selectman in town.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, and
yep.
I met Courtney King, because she would
yep.
Serve in his absence, too. So it oh. was... It was nice. I got to travel to the various cities and towns, and the city was Worcester and the 22 other towns, and I really got the taste of New England government, and that was my first job in government in Massachusetts.
Uh-huh. So New England government's a lot different than California government.
It is, but I like it. Here it's very touchy-feely.
Yeah.
It's very, democracy, where I grew up, the trash got picked up. You wouldn't even know who to call if it didn't get picked up. I mm-hmm. never thought about calling City Hall. Here, it's like you see the democracy in action. You see town meeting, you see people who come to town meeting and have a vote, and you have articles that can pass or fail by one vote, and that vote counts.
Right.
And I like that. I like, I studied in college, and I like this form of government, and I like going to see, where Paul Revere lived and all the colonial revolutionary stuff is interesting.
Yeah, I remember one time going to Faneuil Hall and just sitting in on the tour,
yeah.
And the park ranger was explaining to people there from all over the world and how in New England they still have town meetings where you don't even have to be an official. You can get up and say your mind, and the people were shocked and amazed. You're kidding, they
yes.
do that here? And anyone
so
can
was
get
I
up?
At my first town meeting too, when someone got up and said whatever they wanted
right.
to, and that was very interesting.
So in Uxbridge, we don't even have town meeting representatives. It was literally anyone can
open.
Get up and speak.
Yeah.
It's open town meeting, and a lot of people really appreciate that. And I remember at that Faneuil Hall thing that there were some people that were just amazed by that that's how we operate around here.
And it works, though. That's what's so interesting.
Yeah.
In Charlton, there's really, when we present the budget, and I hope to do this here in Uxbridge, too, but there's, an education of the public on what the budget is.
Mm-hmm.
So when you present it, sure, there's questions that people ask, and you can explain it, but you keep people informed through the whole process, and when they make a decision, it's they understand the repercussions if they don't take action, and that's important too.
Is Charlton open town meeting as well?
Yeah, open.
And how big a town is Charlton in population?
It's about, I think it's 14,000, and it's 48 square miles.
Oh.
So it's much more
spread out,
yeah.
And a little bit bigger than Uxbridge population-wise, but about the same.
Yeah.
So that's interesting. So, so what made you look at the opportunity in Uxbridge?
I had, like I said, I was acquainted with Uxbridge when I was working for the regionalism group, MORE. And then, you know, honestly, it was a career advancement opportunity. They had a very good recruiter. Mm-hmm. He called me a couple of times. I had not thought about putting my name in because I, you know, things were going great at Charlton. And I, when I walked into Charlton, it was a mess. I mean, we had no financial team. There was deficits with budgets. And I thought, you know, that's the great first job to have as a town manager or a town administrator per se, because I got to learn every aspect of the government. So we finally got it all set and things are running smoothly. And then I got the call from the recruiter and he felt it would be a good match for me. And I didn't think about it until we talked more in detail. And it's just, I'm excited. I think there's a lot of opportunity here. And more importantly, I think that the Board of Selectmen are really committed and, mm-hmm. and willing to stand behind a manager and stand behind staff. And mm-hmm. that's important for me.
Yeah, we have a good Board of Selectmen that are committed. They work very hard and put a lot of hours into their job. So
yeah.
I think that you'll enjoy working with every one of them. So, so what are the first things that you want to focus on in town?
Well, it's the season. It's budget, budget, budget.
Yeah.
So there is an interim town manager, Tim, who's working to compile all the information. Hopefully he'll be able to put it into a draft budget. And then I'll be able to meet with the departments to find out what the priorities are.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all just a balancing game, balancing priorities of the departments, the elected officials, with FinCom, and hopefully with collaboration. And I can't forget the schools, too, because that's a very important part. We'll come to some kind of consensus budget, and we won't have to suffer through the process too much.
Well, that sounds good.
Yeah.
Well, I really appreciate you coming on.
Thank you.
And we've been speaking with Jill Myers, who's the new town manager for the town of Uxbridge, and she'll be starting work there in about 3 weeks.
Yeah.
So welcome.
Thank you very much.
We're here at the Whiten Middle School on Granite Street, and we're meeting with the officers of the Whiten School Student Council. And why don't you introduce yourselves?
Hey, I'm Alana Bird, and I'm the president, and my job is I run the meetings, and any big projects that we have, I do them in. Jenny helps me because she's the vice president, and I also do the energizers, which are just activities at the beginning of the meeting to get you, like, pumped up.
Thank you.
I'm Jenny Rosa. I'm the Vice President of Student Council. What I do is I help Alana out with all the projects, and if she's not available to be at the meeting, I'll run it. And I'd just like to say thank you to our advisors, Mrs. O'Brien and Mrs. Eiley, and our principal and vice principal. Dr. Boyage and Mr. Wood.
Always smart to get the principal and vice principal in there.
Hi, I'm Carolyn Cody. I'm the secretary. My job is to write up what happened at the meeting and then pass it at the next one. I'm third in command, pretty much.
Excellent.
My name is Corey Gomes, and I'm the student council treasurer. Basically, what I do, I just keep track of all the funds and all the projects we do. I keep track of all the money and all that stuff.
A money man is a good guy to know. All right. So, what was the student council's first project this year?
Our first project was Homeward Bound, and what we did was the whole school collected money for a family that their home was destroyed in Hurricane Katrina, and they were staying with some relatives in Uxbridge. Their children actually went to the high school for a while, and every Tuesdays and Thursdays, we would collect money in homerooms, and homeroom representatives would bring the money down to the office, and Jenny and I counted the money, and Corey calculated it, and we raised a total of $850. So it was pretty good, and me and Jenny wrote a letter, and we mailed it to the family with a check.
Wow, $850, that's a lot of money to raise.
Yeah, I hope so.
And now is the family still in town, do you know? Or?
I think they moved back to
Mississippi.
They did go back. Oh, well, that was awfully nice of you guys. It feels good to help people like that, doesn't it? So I understand that you also helped Mrs. Simons and the Uxbridge Supports Our Troops. I understand, I know, because I'm a member of that, that you helped us with our holiday project. And you can someone explain what you did for that?
Okay. What we did is we made shoe boxes, and inside them we put things that the soldiers needed, like shampoo and phone cards, and we sent them over after we wrapped them. And these things really helped the soldiers. I know this because I wrote to a soldier last year, and like the soldiers really enjoy them. And my soldier actually came to visit me, and he gave me a headdress. I don't have it with me right now, but it was really.
And who was the soldier?
Officer Scott Brown. He's a police officer in town.
And he brought you a headdress?
Yeah.
Oh, that was awfully nice. That was a surprise, too, I bet, right?
Yeah.
That's great.
My parents planned it.
I mentioned that there were 48 shoeboxes filled, so.
Right, 48 out of 140 total. So you guys were very big contributors to that. I know it's very appreciated because the soldiers are sending USOT all kinds of thank you letters. So you should be very proud of yourselves. How else does the student council do? What else do they do for community projects?
One of the things we did was a food pantry drive, which we collected canned foods and everything. Then we gave them to the food pantry so they could distribute them.
That's great.
There are two cars full of those too. So there's a lot of canned goods.
Wow, that's a lot. Now, does the student council do any projects for things outside of Uxbridge?
Well, outside of Uxbridge this year, we've done a coat drive for the people in Boston, and we collected over about 14 large trash bags full of the coats and other winter outerwear, and a local family took them up to the Boston Common where they distributed them to whoever needed them.
Oh, that's terrific. Now, what kind of projects are you doing in the school itself?
In school, many student council officers and people in the student council help if we have any visitors, such as the NELMS conference people, and any socials or dances, students volunteer. And for Teacher Appreciation Week and for the holidays, like such as Christmas, we send out cards to the staff, and that's pretty much it.
Wow, that's great. So I understand that the student council has instituted a new program this year. Can someone explain to me what that is?
Okay. Well, this year we've done something called Best Buddies, where we have children become good friends with special education kids, and they meet about once a month, and they just share snacks and hang out.
Wow, that's terrific. So are you all looking forward to being in the student council when you get up to the high school?
Yeah, I am.
Have you been up to any of their meetings?
Yes, we actually go to some of the meetings. We don't do anything there, but we just observe what goes on, so we have an idea of if we want to go there, and we like report back to our student council on some of the things we did, and we can get ideas from them.
So how many of you here are eighth graders?
Me and Alana.
Okay, you two. So you'll be going up next year.
Yeah.
And go ahead.
We're very excited to go and help our community there.
Well, the student council at the high school has been awarded a couple times, I know, in the last few years, the best student council in the state. So I know you'll be a good addition up there. And what grades are you two in?
We're in sixth.
Both in sixth grade. Okay. So the White in school is what grades?
Fifth through eighth.
Fifth through eighth. Well, I'm glad you guys came on the show. Thank you very, very much. And it certainly is nice to see some nice, bright, young, energetic people like yourself getting involved in student government. And I'm sure that everyone out in Uxbridge is going to be happy to see the product that we have in our middle school. You should be very proud of yourselves. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And that's it for our segment here at the Library of the Whiten School on Grand Street. And we've been meeting with officers of the Whiten School Student Council. Many people contacted us to tell us how much they enjoyed last month's musical performance by Brett Penza and Greg Lowell. They're overnight sensations, and they're back on Uxbridge My Kind of Town with another performance. But they've also developed a website, which I'm displaying here on the screen now. Be sure to check it out. So without further ado, let's welcome back Brett and Greg, otherwise known as the Irrelevant Bluesmen of Uxbridge.
My mother told me before she passed away, she said, son, when I'm gone, don't forget to pray, 'cause there'll be hard times, hard times. Who knows? Better than I. Well, I soon found out just what you meant when I had to pawn my clothes just to pay the rent. Oh, there'd be hard times, hard times. Who knows better than I? be no more sorrow. When I pass away, there be no more hard times, no more hard times. You know what I say. No more hard times today.
Our next guest is Uxbridge Cable TV coordinator and co-producer of Uxbridge, My Kind of Town, Barry Giles. Hi, Barry. How you doing?
Pretty good, Dave. How about yourself?
Good. Thanks for coming on the show.
No problem.
You're usually behind the scenes guy.
I know. It's very odd for me to be in front of a camera right now. Yeah.
But you're here to promote Uxbridge Community Television.
Yes, I am.
So how long have you been on the job now, Barry?
I've been with Uxbridge for about 2 years now.
Okay. And so where'd you grow up?
I originally grew up in Bellingham.
Okay.
And I've been actually been involved in television production for 20 years now.
Well, how'd you get started?
I got started when I was a teenager, actually. My dad helped me get this going. My father was actually a hockey coach.
Really?
At Bellingham High School.
Oh.
When I was a junior in high school. And one day, you know, my mother called me up and said, listen, you got to come home. Your father wants to see you. So I said, okay. Walked into the living room, and there was a video camera set up. And I said, what's this for? And he goes, well, you're going to help me coach the team. So I started by videotaping hockey games for my father, and he would review the tapes. And then towards the end of my junior year, it's when cable television came into town.
Uh-huh.
And my father had read an article in the newspaper about the board of directors meeting to start up local access and said, you might want to get involved with this. So walked up to the center of town and became the youngest board of director for Bellingham Access Television. And at that time, I was 17 years old.
Wow.
So I got involved as a teenager and just took off from there.
So did you go to school for this sort of thing?
After high school, I originally was going to go to school for journalism,
mm-hmm.
but changed my mind after 1 year and went to a technical school in Rhode Island for radio and television broadcasting.
Oh, and here you are.
And here I am.
So where else have you worked?
After I completed 1 year of school in broadcasting school, I ended up at Channel 12, WPRI in Rhode Island.
Mm-hmm.
And I've done various jobs in local affiliates, which, you know, 4, 5, 7,
mm-hmm.
those types of stations. And then got involved, worked in Milford, continued to volunteer in Bellingham for years. And my last job was in the town of Sharon. I was there for 10 years.
Uh-huh. And you lived in Uxbridge while you worked in Sharon?
I've been in Uxbridge for about 10 years.
Oh, okay.
So I was in Bellingham and then moved to Uxbridge when I got married.
Uh-huh.
So the commute was about 45 minutes. But
right, that's not bad.
It was worth it.
So what changes have been made in PEG Access over the last year?
Well, the main change would be my position.
Mm-hmm.
Being the program coordinator, I am now in charge of all three channels, public, education, and government. Make sure programming gets on, and also help produce programming.
Mm-hmm. So what type of programming are you seeing coming out of the community now, besides Uxbridge, my kind of town.
Well, this is a perfect example. You know, a volunteer like yourself coming forward with an idea for a program and me assisting you to make sure the program gets on the air.
Mm-hmm.
We've continued to cover government meetings. We're trying to expand our coverage of government meetings, especially live broadcasts.
Mm-hmm.
On the public end, we have a few more volunteers producing programming, plus the people that have continued throughout the years, Mr. Bagdasarian and yourself and Harry Moscow doing your promotions for the 4th of July.
Mm-hmm.
We also have some outside programming coming in.
Yep.
From other communities also.
But Junior Alvin does a lot of stuff.
Mr. Alvin is incredible.
Yeah.
He's been a very valuable source to me. He owns all his own equipment.
Right.
So he's able to do everything on his own. But
mm-hmm.
he's done a huge job
right.
for us.
Right.
Hopefully, you know, we're going to try and get more people interested. And, if, you know, people have ideas for programs.
Right.
You know, you can always contact me. I do have the bug planted in a few people right now about some programming. I'm just going to encourage them to move forward.
Well, I got to say, you've been extremely helpful to me to get this off the ground, and actually wouldn't have been able to do won't be able to do it without you. And it's fun, you know. So if you have
absolutely.
An idea that you want to try out and go to Barry, he'll help you with it. And the town's got all the equipment, so you don't need any equipment.
Absolutely. Actually, the equipment we're using here right now is all brand new equipment
mm-hmm.
that I had in my last year's budget, and it's actually located in the high school right now, and it's to be used for educational purposes, but we're kind of using it as swing space until we figure out where we can put a new, you know, public access studio for the community.
I think one of the biggest changes that you've made, Barry, that have had an impact on the cable television is the setup that you put in the selectmen's meeting room. So we're
yes.
actually doing the three-camera shooting there using remote cameras.
Right. And we're going to be expanding that once again. Actually, just the other day, I received the cameras for the school committee set up. We're going to be putting remote cameras in there.
Excellent.
We're also going to be putting remote cameras in Lower Town Hall.
Mm-hmm.
So as far as our government end goes, we will be, you know, hopefully covering more meetings with this particular setup. It's going to make it much more easier.
Now, you don't have to be an expert in video production to be a volunteer.
Absolutely not.
So what's the process? I
Absolutely
want to volunteer.
Not. If anybody's interested in volunteering, they could either contact me at Town Hall.
Mm-hmm.
My phone number is 278-0708. I'm usually at Town Hall between 8 and 4. Sometimes I'm in and out running around doing different events. We've joined up with the Adult Education Program,
mm-hmm.
and at the end of February, we're going to be running a workshop, which is free to anyone who's interested. That's all you need is just an interest
mm-hmm.
to see how public access television works. We're going to be doing three different segments in the class. The first one would be studio production, which is what we're doing right now
mm-hmm.
With the new equipment. Then we'll be discussing portable equipment and then editing. So if you have any interest, and it's open to everyone.
That's excellent.
You know, middle school kids, high school kids, adults, seniors, anyone. You don't need any prior experience, just an interest.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all hands-on. My philosophy is the only way to learn how to do it is to do it.
Right.
And hopefully, you know, we'll encourage more people to come down and so on. And even if we talked about ideas,
mm-hmm.
if you have an idea for a program and you don't want to take the workshop, that doesn't prevent you from approaching me to do the program. We can get volunteers in to do the directing, the camera work, and everything else. So if
mm-hmm.
you have an idea for a program, if you're a chef at a restaurant and you want to do a cooking program, or if you're a financial advisor and you want to inform the community about different things, a new program we have right now is with Angel Muscatelli from Angel's Real Estate talking about real estate
mm-hmm.
and some of the issues pertaining to real estate and how to buy the house and, you know, financing
yep.
and so on. So these, you know, once again, if you have an idea, we can always, you know, work with you to get it on the air.
I think there's a lot of people out there that just got that desire. They want to do it, but they just don't take that first step. So
right.
you got to take the plunge. You got to do it. Give it a shot, and I think that you'll be happy with the results. So is there a stipend for volunteers if someone wanted to run the camera, say, at the selectmen's meeting or
right.
the school committee?
Right. We do. I am looking for people to help me with the government coverage.
Mm-hmm.
And we do have stipends available for people. If they want to help with, you know, government coverage and so on.
Right.
As far as programs like this, it's usually on a volunteer basis.
Uh-huh.
So we're looking.
So if someone wanted to run the camera at the remote cameras
mm-hmm.
at the selectmen's meeting, that'd be a great job for like a high school kid,
Absolutely.
Something that wanted to make a few extra bucks.
Absolutely, and also they can use it as community service towards their credits at school.
So they do get credit for community service for doing that. Now, how does someone get involved?
Once again, very simple. Just contact me.
Just give me a call.
If you're not available for the workshops that we run at night, I'm available during the day. We can do one-on-one workshops.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're interested in covering, you know, your daughter's soccer game or something like that, and that's all you want to do, I can show you how to run the camera. If you're interested in announcing, you know, if there's somebody out there, the next Howard Cosell, absolutely. And I'm really hoping that this really takes off in the educational end, because I'd like to see a lot of the high school kids get involved, covering more high school sports, announcing, running camera, and then eventually go into college and pursue. And Sharon, 80% of my volunteers were high school kids.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I got them started young at the middle school, and they followed it up through high school and eventually gone into college. And some of them are very successful.
Mm-hmm.
I have one gentleman that works at ESPN, and I, you know, keep in contact with him once in a while, and I always joke with him. I said, you got my job. I'll get you for it, but you got my job.
Right.
But it is, we're hoping that it will really pick up in the high school.
Yeah, with all the cable channels now on TV and all the shows, it's a growing industry, really.
Absolutely, it is.
So what kind of changes are you planning for the future for Uxbridge Cable Television?
Well, first thing is space. I'd really like to see a public access station. We have plans, if the Blanchard facility gets up and running, we plan on utilizing space there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're in the process right now of updating equipment. When I first started, a lot of the equipment is very outdated.
Mm-hmm.
With the digital format now, trying to get digital cameras in and so on. Other things, you know, one of the things we were just discussing the other night was downstreaming government meetings onto the town website.
Oh.
So people can view them at your convenience. You know, if you have high-speed internet, it works out really well. Other things, once again, volunteers, trying to increase my volunteer pool, and once again, increase programming. You know, just either getting outside programming or producing it in town.
Right.
I think there's a lot going on in this community that a lot of people don't know about, and public access television is a great way, and this is a perfect example.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great way to inform the community of what's going on and what's being done in this community, the positive things that are being done in this community.
Mm-hmm.
Since day one, when I got up in front of that podium and introduced myself to the selectmen, I really believe that the town has no idea what a positive aspect public access television could have in the community.
Right.
You know, just simply covering sporting events, recreation sporting events, high school sporting events. Kids love to see themselves on TV, especially if they win.
Right.
You know, it's great to have. And the parents, you know, have a record of their kids. They're not out there with their little camcorders. You know, you have somebody else do it. We provide copies if you want a copy of a sporting event or a program or anything like that. You know, I've seen it in Sharon. It was a huge, huge impact on the family, the kids, and the community in general. And I really want to take that and bring it to Uxbridge and try to create a positive feel for public access television. I know it's been discussed a lot in government realms about funding and the money and what's going on. But I really, you know, my goal is to prove to the community that it's worth it.
Mm-hmm.
It really is.
Well, I think I've been enjoying utilizing the cable TV channel for quite a few years now myself for various things, and I do appreciate it. It's a great medium. So we've been speaking with the coordinator of Uxbridge Cable Television, Barry Giles, and he's also co-producer of Uxbridge, My Kind of Town. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Dave.
Thanks for all that you're doing to help me out.
Thank you.
Well, that's our show for this month. And remember, if you or your organization would like to be a guest on Uxbridge My Kind of Town, you can email us at uxbridgemykindoftown@hotmail.com, or you can call 508-278-5131. Hey, we hope you have a wonderful February, and thank you for joining us once again on Uxbridge My Kind of Town.
Let me tell you folks about my kind.